Hello and welcome to my presentation about visualizing the transition of large networks via dimensionality reduction to illustrate the evolution of the human brain. My name is Florian Gangelberger and I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the VIVIS Research Center. Spatial brain networks represent the structural, functional or genetic relations between brain areas. The brain is inherently not static. Investigating changes over time can reveal dynamics that can lead to novel insights into brain's function or mental disorders. When visualizing spatial brain networks, one can easily run into problems regarding clutter, occlusions, and complexity. Here, for example, we are looking at a static brain network with just 22 brain regions or nodes, where we have already 484 edges. In recent years, the data has become available not only on the regional level. Just one example. The Allen Human Brain Atlas, where we have microarray data of 3,702 biopsy sites, here depicted as black dots. And for every biopsy site, we have the expression level of 30,000 genes. So for every dot, we have 30,000 values. We also know which brain regions the biopsy sites belong. Here, we selected five that were relevant to our domain experts: the prefrontal cortex, the amygdala areas, the hippocampus, the striatum, and the thalamus. When we use this data to create brain networks, for example by computing the correlation of a set of genes between biopsy sites, we end up with a spatial gene co-expression or affinity matrix that has 3,702 times 3,702 connections. Even when visualizing several hundred of these biopsy sites, it is hard to compare two matrices generated by the correlation of different subsets of genes. This does not get better when using, for example, force-directed layouts. An alternative approach represents dimensionality reduction. Instead of visualizing the individual edge information, the affinity, we map the data to an embedding space. In this embedding space, edge information is encoded in the distance between nodes. So when we see this embedding space here, every dot is a biopsy site. So we colored every biopsy site by the associated brain region. And dots that are close together in this space, they have a high affinity, and dots that are farther apart have a low affinity. Problem with this embedding space is that it depends on the data, so the spaces are not comparable for different affinity matrices. The solution for this problem is to create a common embedding space and map the data onto it. For this approach, we conceive the following method. We start with one affinity matrix for each time point, which we ultimately want to compare. Over these affinity matrices, we compute the mean affinity matrix. Then we use locality preserving projection, or LPP, which is a linear approximation of nonlinear dimensionality reduction to create the embedding space. For this, it is necessary to row-wise threshold the top 10% to emphasize on the strongest connections or strongest affinities for each row. Otherwise, we would get more blobby representation in the embedding space. When creating this mean embedding space, LPP creates a projection matrix, which we use to project the individual matrices of separate time points to the same embedding space. To visualize the data and trace changes of regions over time, we conceived a visual encoding. First, we started with the obvious choice, to just color the dots and nodes by the associated brain regions. But here, it is not possible to trace the individual dots over time. Therefore, we tried to use a convex hull, encompassing the majority of the region's dots. But the regions are spread widely over the plot, so this did not succeed. It was also not very convincing to our domain experts to plot the movement of this brain region center of gravity between different time points, and it was hard to interpret. We then came up with this approach. We overlaid the local density of the region's associated nodes on the mapping. We removed the color coding of individual nodes as it would interfere with the overlaid density. To compute the local density, we used a two-dimensional kernel density estimation evaluated on a square grid. These clouds, or density maps that you see here, of major brain regions are then combined via alpha blending in a single figure per time point. The transitions are visualized by juxtaposing individual time points, which I will show you in one of the next slides. But before, I have to explain to you what you will see. For a previous study, we used evolutionary data describing the selection pressure, so if individual genes changed at several evolutionary time points. We used this measure of selection pressure to weight the gene expression from the LNU membrane atlas, which I showed you before. These time points are called last common ancestor, or LCA. So time point LCA1 means the evolutionary changes of genes when the last common ancestor of mouse and bush baby evolved. LCA2 is the last common ancestor of bush baby and marmoset. LCA3 the marmoset and macaque, and so on until the modern human. We use these to create 8 affinity matrices of 8 evolutionary time points. So here we see all 8 time points. It was possible to focus on the deformation of and shifting between the colored point clouds, representing the brain regions over multiple time points. Several subcortical areas showed intra-regional deformation, so they were splitting into subclusters. For example, the thalamus in green at LCA2 and LCA3, or the striatum at LCA3, 4, and 5. In contrast to these subcortical regions, cortical coevolution in the prefrontal cortex, here in brown, spanned more variations across time period and remained continuously flexible, as indicated in the literature by chimp-human comparison. We can see this also when flipping through the images, how the brown areas continuously split up and merge into different clusters. Now to the discussion. We see the major contribution of this work in the mapping of individual matrices to a common embedding space and our proposed visual encoding. By using small multiples, affinity changes within and between brain regions were clearly visible. Given the size of the matrices, this would not have been possible with heat maps on node link diagrams, as I showed you in the beginning of this presentation. There are also some limitations. The quality of the individual mappings decreases with the variance, especially with more outliers in the data. One way to counteract this is the robust estimation of the mean, for example with trimmed mean or median, or in extreme cases with an alignment, for example by Procrustes analysis. Also, the amount of clusters of interest to be traced are limited by the finite amount of colors that can be visualized. This is especially crucial since the outcome of the analysis depends on which clusters have been selected and are thereby visually traceable. We want to point out that this represents just the first step towards a more detailed analysis. Although it allows a quick assessment, visual analytic tools could enable the interactive selections of clusters or brain regions via linked views with brain anatomy, or the direct investigation of individual nodes via brushing. As you already saw, the use of animations and scrolling instead of small multiples could also be useful. That's it. Thank you for your attention.